Ladies and gentlemen, welcome to the 2021 induction celebration. Please direct your attention to the video screens and listen to congratulatory messages for tonight's honorees.
How do we begin to express how much you mean to us? You embody the ideals of our university and our growing city.
Pull-up jumper, yes, sir!
The wins, the championships, they tell only part of the story. Your legacy lives on through the players you've coached, the lives you've impacted, the university you've inspired. Thank you, Coach Bird.
Yeah, Tom and I play, you know, competed against each other. You know, we were fierce rivals at University of Oklahoma and University of Texas. We played a lot of golf together. We sat on bleachers all over the country, recruiting together. And then something funny happened along the way. We became friends. You know, Susie and Tom Penders are absolute treasures. Tom is just one of the great basketball guys. Everybody that knows him likes him. And if you get to know him, you'll see why. I love Tom Penders. I think he's a great guy. I love coaching against him, but I like him a lot more being his friend. The fact that he's been inducted into the Hall of Fame is a well-deserved honor. He came along at a time when they don't have what they have now. You know, college basketball was still searching for an identity. Tom was a great athlete in college too. I mean, he could play baseball, basketball. He did all that stuff at a high level. But Tom was determined to be who he was. He coached to his personality, and I would hope that for all coaches, you know, be who you are. He wasn't interested in anybody's opinion. He didn't care what you thought of it. He did it his way, and that's a hell of a way to be going to the Hall of Fame, knowing you did it your way. So congratulations, my friend. Hats off to you, and love you, Tom and Susie.
From all the Tar Heels, congratulations, Antoine. Much deserved.
Antoine, congratulations, my man. It's really an honor to be part of the Collegiate Hall of Fame. Really excited for you. Really happy that this accomplishment has happened.
There's Antoine working the glass like the Windex man. And look at the emotion. Look at the jubilation.
Antoine Jameson, congratulations making the College Basketball Hall of Fame. Well deserved.
And there's the man, the 3M man. He's magical, he's magnificent, he's marvelous, he's America's best, Antoine Jameson!
Ladies and gentlemen, tonight's induction presentation will begin in 5 minutes. Please be seated immediately. Thank you. Welcome to the National Collegiate Basketball Hall of Fame induction. Thank you for being a part of this historic event in which we recognize college basketball's all-time greats. We hope you enjoy this celebration. In the year 2006, the game of men's college basketball welcomed a new mecca by inducting the inaugural induction class of the National Collegiate Basketball Hall of Fame. That historic moment launched an annual celebration of the greatest players, coaches, and contributors in the sport's magnificent history. Since that time, unforgettable icons of the game, as well as individuals who have helped shape it behind the scenes, have seen their names etched in the walls of ultimate honor. Tonight, the NABC Foundation is proud to present the 16th Annual Induction Class, featuring eight luminaries who have secured their places in college basketball history. A dominating presence in the ACC from 1982 to 86, and arguably the greatest player in Maryland Terrapin history, the late Len Bias. A four-year pillar at UCLA in the 70s, leading the Bruins to 102 wins, two-time All-American David Greenwood. One of the most prolific scorers in college basketball history, with more than 3,000 career points, Bradley University legend Hershey Hawkins. Two-time All-American and 1992 UPI National Player of the Year at Ohio State, Jim Jackson. One of the all-time greats at tradition-rich North Carolina, 1998 National Player of the Year, Antoine Jamison. University of Kansas All-American, who led the Jayhawks to three consecutive conference titles from 1995 to 98, Paul Pierce. The man who brought Belmont University to prominence during 33 years as head coach and winner of 805 career games, Rick Byrd. A master of leading team turnarounds who won 649 career games and took four schools to the NCAA tournament, Tom Penders. And now, please welcome the host for tonight's show, college basketball analyst Andy Katz, and from NBA TV, Stephanie Reddy.
Wow. Whoa, we're loud.
We are. Hello, everyone.
So first off, I just want to say it is an honor to work with Stephanie Reddy, who I've known for quite some time.
Don't tell him how long.
Trailblazer. She was the first full-time female assistant in the men's game under Coppin State and former head coach Fang Mitchell more than two decades ago.
I told you not to tell them how long.
So a trailblazer. Now she's doing tremendous work for Turner Sports and TNT and NBA TV. But before we start, just one quick thing from me, that this is a great thrill for me as someone who dreamed of playing college basketball. And I went to all the camps. I grew up in Newton, Mass. My dad was a professor at Boston College. So this was an era, and I know Rick and Tom will remember this, back when college coaches used to go to everyone else's camps. And so back in the 80s, in the Boston area, at BC basketball camp, you'd have Jim Calhoun at Northeastern and Rick Pitino at BU and Togo Palazzi from Holy Cross, who would throw his son into the backboard, basically, and really work him out. And then, of course, we had Gary Williams and Tom Davis at BC. And so from that point, to, you know, watching the first Final Four, as I walked by that photo there of Magic and Bird in 79, to covering Indiana and Wisconsin, I remember in 87, the triple overtime game, to all those memories, to TARC, as Tom knows, when I was covering Fresno and New Mexico before that, to 18 years at ESPN, to now Turner Sports, Fox Sports, Big Ten Network, and all the 30 years of memories, so I can date myself here, 30 plus years of memories of my adult life covering this sport in men's college basketball. It's been a thrill to, over, we can't see over there, but We saw earlier today the shot of the game on the USS Carl Vinson that we did on 11-11-11, the 10-year anniversary of that game between Michigan State and North Carolina. So it is a great thrill for me to be here to talk about the great careers of people that I covered that have now retired as a player and a coach. So I'm just thrilled to be here, and this is your night, so I'm just happy to be a part of it.
Yes, and I'm thrilled to be partnered with you, Andy, because as he told you all, we go back a long, long time, and there would not be a college basketball event if you were not in the building. So this makes it legitimate. We're all ready to get started, and we're excited to celebrate you all.
So this class, as you saw there, and for those watching at home, I mean, this has eight luminaries, and this is an era where we have, you know, we're celebrating really the four-year, the three-year, the two-year right. player. Now we're in the one and the two, but maybe we'll get back to the three and the four, and unbelievable coaches. So, you know, and we just saw before just the history of this event of previous classes.
It's unbelievable. I mean, when you saw the inaugural class, it set the tone for what we were here celebrating. You saw those names all on the stage at once. When do you ever get to see John Wooden on the stage with other luminaries? It doesn't happen. And so this is a special event because, like that very first night, tonight we are going to be celebrating eight people who deserve to have their names recognized in the Hall of Fame. We're excited.
And so what I love also about this class is it stretches the breadth of the sport. As Rick Byrd had to deal with different levels of college basketball and building a real power, and I don't like the term mid-major. I mean, nothing about you was mid-major. You were at the highest level, and obviously Paul and Anton at the high majors, as well as Jim at Ohio State, and then Tom climbed up throughout the course of his career at various levels, and David with the era of everything that you did at UCLA, that obviously now with the number one team in the country, that era could be coming back. And of course, the late great Len Bias. You know, I was in the Boston area, so I mean, I obviously, you know, watched him in the ACC prior to that, and everything about Len Bias I can remember was an unbelievable talent that we can't wait to talk to Dr. Lenise Bias in just a little bit.
Yes, and I grew up in Maryland, and so I remember vividly that as a child, we thought Len Bias was ours. We all thought that he belonged to us, so I'm happy to share the stage with Dr. Bias and get to talk to her about her son. But you talked about this class. I wrote down some notes because I was so impressed. You all have done so many things, but when you combine all of your accolades and accomplishments, over 60 seasons in the NBA, this group, 13 NBA All-Star selections, 9 Conference Player of the Year. 9. There's only 8 people here, and 2 of them are coaches, so that tells you something. 6 Coach of the Year awards among the coaches. So this is a very impressive group. You all should be highly honored to be included with each other.
And the other thing, before we get to the way we're going to set up the evening, is that obviously the Naismith Basketball Hall of Fame in Springfield does recognize college basketball for the men and the women, but clearly men's college basketball needed its own Hall of Fame to make sure that coaches and players and contributors to this great game, the sport that we love, that has become our life, is celebrated. And so that's what's so wonderful about this facility and the fact that we get a chance every year to recognize so many unbelievable accomplishments, because all of you have obviously dedicated a portion of your life to this part of the sport.
All right.
The way it's going to work is we are going to bring up, after a short video, 2 honorees at the same time, and we're going to talk to both of them. So like Noah's Ark, we're going to have 4 groups of 2 because we have a nice even number of 8. And our first inductees that are going to come up here prior here in a moment, but Hersey Hawkins and Jim Jackson, 2 unbelievable scorers in their prime at Bradley and the Ohio State University.
The formula for a successful basketball team always includes one key ingredient, and that is possessing a talented, explosive shooting guard. Players who consistently pour in points and force the defense to play on the perimeter. 2 highly recruited athletes at that position who remained in their home states to play collegiately and went on to become prolific scorers were Bradley's Hersey Hawkins and Ohio State's Jim Jackson. A heralded high school player from Chicago, Illinois, Hershey Hawkins elected to take his basketball skills 3 hours down the road to Bradley University. During his four-year college career, he started all 125 games from 1984 to 1988 and became one of the most lethal scorers in college basketball history. His 3,008 career points ranked 10th all-time in the NCAA Division I record books and still stand as the most in Missouri Valley Conference history. His scoring total is just one of 14 records he holds at Bradley. Hawkins was nearly unstoppable during his final two seasons, becoming a two-time All-American and two-time Missouri Valley Player of the Year while leading the Braves to two conference titles. As a senior, Hawkins was the consensus National Player of the Year after leading the country with a stunning average of 36.3 points per game. He was selected sixth overall by the Los Angeles Clippers in the 1988 NBA Draft and went on to score over 14,000 points during his 13-year professional career, arguably the greatest player to ever wear a Bradley University uniform. The number 33 jersey worn by Hawkins has been retired in honor of his brilliant career. A McDonald's All-American high school talent from Toledo, Ohio, Jim Jackson took his remarkable skills as a 6'6" shooting guard to Ohio State University in 1989. He made an immediate impact on the Buckeyes as a freshman, averaging 16 points and 5.5 rebounds per game while helping Ohio State reach the NCAA tournament after a two-year absence. Over the next two seasons, Jackson vaulted the Buckeyes to back-to-back Big Ten titles and was voted the Conference Player of the Year, along with earning status as a consensus first-team All-American. As a junior, Jackson earned National Player of the Year honors after a sensational season in which he averaged 22.4 points, 6.8 rebounds, and 4 assists per game while taking the Buckeyes to the Elite Eight. By the time his three seasons were complete, Jackson left Ohio State with 1,785 points and a career 19.2 scoring average while shooting over 50% from the field. He became the fourth overall pick of the Dallas Mavericks in the 1992 NBA Draft and played 14 seasons in the league. Jackson's number 22 jersey hangs in the rafters at Value City Arena, a lofty recognition as one of the all-time greats in the history of Ohio State basketball.
Please welcome the phenomenal Hershey Hawkins and Jim Jackson.
All right, first of all, these guys look great. Look like
yes.
Still, I told you earlier, you look like you can still suit up despite a little of the gray there.
Well, like I said earlier, look on the TV. Don't believe everything you see. I can't play a bit now.
First off, your career at Bradley, as we've highlighted, was unbelievable, averaging 36.3 points a game. National Player of the Year honors as a senior. Let's go back to Bradley. That era of college basketball when you were playing, what was that era like for you playing at Bradley, especially being a contender before you even won it, but being a contender for Player of the Year at Bradley?
Well, I think, first of all, playing, and I'm quite sure most of the guys will say that, you know, playing at a school where you think you have the greatest fans in the country, and I think Bradley fans were fantastic. 3 hours, you know, south of Chicago, where I grew up, so I'm pretty much playing at home. The basketball phenomenal at the time, Missouri Valley Conference, was, I thought, even though it was considered a mid-major, very talented individuals in that conference, and just a challenge every single night to go out there and figure out a way to score when you know the other team is designing a defense to stop you. So. I just took it as a challenge every single night.
Jim, you being from Ohio, had a stellar career, as we've chronicled already, at the Ohio State University. With your jersey hanging up at Value City, what does that mean to you when you recognize that that's happened?
Well, I think at the time when I got my jersey retired, it wasn't so much about me, it was about my teammates too, because without them, I wouldn't have been able to be as successful as a player. But I think everybody knows and understands that having those kind of teammates allows our job to be a lot easier. And so when the jersey went up in the rafters, I thanked everyone, our managers, coaches, the players, because without that success, none of that didn't matter. It didn't matter how many points you scored or what you wanted to do. If the team wasn't successful enough, then those accolades never came. So it meant so much more to me that they could be a part of it and share a part of it. And it wasn't just my jersey going up. It was everybody that contributed.
Awesome.
What did playing in the Big Ten, similar to Hersey, but in that era, how did that make you a better player in college and then ultimately in the NBA?
Well, it was on the back end of Michigan winning the national championship in 1989. Then you had Iowa, Illinois, who were both Sweet 16, Final Four teams during that time. So the Big Ten was very competitive. Michigan State, of course, Purdue. I think growing up, I was a Big East fan, though. I never wanted to go to Iowa State. I loved the Big East. At that time, Georgetown, Syracuse, you know, St. John's, that was it for me. But as I got older and understood the significance of the Big Ten and what it meant, and Gary Williams at the time, we talked about Gary Williams, he kind of transformed the university from not just a football school, but a basketball school. And then Randy Ayers took over. So being a part of the Big Ten, the history of it, John Wooden, Purdue, and the number of coaches that were there, the Lou Henson, you know, the Bobby Knights, Judd Heathcote, you know, Gene Cady. That whole dynamic of having the Big Ten at that time was spectacular. And to be a part of that, to me, was one of the best conferences outside the ACC, of course, and the Big 12, but in basketball. So it taught me a lot.
So while we're talking about all of our accomplishments, I say our because, you know, I'm up here, but we're really talking about you two. Hersey, you had so many records at Bradley. When you think about those, which one are you most proud of, or which one did you enjoy accomplishing?
Scoring, of course.
We knew that.
I mean, and honestly, I saw the 14 other records. I don't even know what they are. Because the only one I ever paid attention to was the scoring. And, you know, so that's the one I'm most proud of. But, you know, I think, you know, Jim said it, without, I think, great teammates and a great coaching staff, you know, none of that is possible. To have coaches that believe in you and that trust the fact that you can go out there and do it every night, and then have players who are just as talented as you are, but are willing to sacrifice their game for the betterment of the team to, you know, to get me open, you know, that meant a lot. So, you know, I share this with a lot of those guys, and especially one of my assistant coaches is here during those years, and, you know, glad he came down. So, but the original question, scoring.
Got it.
So, Hersey, we are still seeing this today, where players who are not at one of the headliner schools, if you will, John Moran at Murray State, Damian Lillard at Weber, they still have to sort of prove themselves even more. You went to what one of those schools is not, you know, one of the Power Five, if you will, to use a loose term, but how much did you feel like you still had to prove, you know, more because you were Bradley within college basketball and then ultimately when you were in the NBA?
Well, I definitely, you play with a chip on your shoulder when you realize that you think that you're overlooked or that people don't think that you're as talented as so many other guys. And trust me, I watch them as well. You know, I watch Jim and, you know, Antoine and Paul Pierce, nightmare to guard, by the way, nightmare. So, you know, but it was just one of those things that I knew that I had to prove myself. And what motivated me the most was I can remember a guy writing an article for Sporting News, and he said that I would be the next Steve Alford. I would play 2 or 3 years in the league, and I would be done. And I hung that in my locker in Philadelphia. And when I made the All-Star team, I actually took it down. I was like, okay, I've made it.
Did you send it to Steve Alford?
I did not. not to knock Steve Alford, you know. but that was my motivation.
Jim, before you got to Ohio State, not great seasons, right, for the basketball program. You come in as a freshman and immediately make an impact. How are you able to do that so quickly, and what was that process like?
Well, it was a lot tougher because Gary Williams recruited me and he left. So Randy Ayers took over, and we didn't realize that Randy was 33 at the time, so he was the first African-American coach at Ohio State, and he was only 33 years old. So we had our challenges. But the foundation that Gary had put together, because he had recruited a Trey Glee, who was a McDonald's All-American, a Chris Gent, who was a McDonald's All-American, and a Perry Carter from D.C., who was a McDonald's. So the foundation was already there. We just needed somebody to guide us. And I was able to come in highly recruited, but I fit in with that core group. So we had our challenges at the beginning. I mean, we got drilled a few times, blew out early in the season. But it helped us kind of navigate who we were going to be eventually as a team. But I was just another piece of the puzzle to what the foundation had already been laid by Gary Williams.
So, Jim, we're all old enough now where your son's older, but to see a child now go through college basketball, already has gone through, play at the highest level, compete for a national championship, do things that you also were able to do, not as far in the tournament, but what did that mean to you to see the family Jackson name continue at such a high level in college basketball?
Well, it was interesting because he chose to go to Wisconsin, of all places, all right? But it was a choice he had to make and he had to deal with. And he had his challenges while he was there. But also, as you know, I covered him being a broadcaster while he was playing. Now, they took me off his games for whatever reason. I guess they thought I was going to be biased or something. But I would still cover him. And one of the emotional times that we had was a Big Ten tournament. You weren't there, but his sophomore year, we were finally on stage together. And it was emotional because that's the first time we were together in that. But it was a precursor to what would happen his junior year when he missed the shot. I don't know how you missed it. I don't know what you was thinking. You must have got that from your mother on her side. But he missed the shot to get to the championship game against Kentucky. And I had to interview him after the game. So all of those emotions that boil over all that time, and this is my son, and I got to sit here, and we got to talk, and I got to be professional. But having the ability to cover him for his 4 years was phenomenal. Because as a parent, all you ever want is for your child to be able to succeed. And trust me, he lets me know, well, Dad, you didn't get to Final Fours. I did. I got the championship, which is what you want. You want your child to always be able to strive and have more things. You prepare them to be more successful. So for me, it was phenomenal. I had a chance not to just to watch him, but to be a part of it too for 4 years.
Hersey Hawkins, let's get back to your scoring.
Okay.
So you had a game where you scored 60 points against a Division I opponent. Exactly. What do you remember most about that performance? It hasn't been done often at the Division I level.
You know, my assistant coach and I, we were talking about that game last night. And I told him I could look at my college career and there are very few games that I regret or I look back and say, I could have done something different or maybe. But that was one game that afterwards, after a week or so, I thought, man, I regret that game because I could have easily had 70. it was just one of them games where I had it going. I knew I couldn't miss,
yes. But
I decided to pass a little more because at one point you feel like I'm shooting every ball. I have to get other guys involved. So I started passing a little, and because the coach was here, he said I had 8 or 9 assists. And I'm like, why didn't y'all tell me to shoot more? So that was one of the games I regret. I should have had 70.
I love that. I love it.
Well, ladies and gentlemen, Hersey Hawkins and Jim Jackson.
Well done.
All right, so our next two that we're going to bring up here momentarily. David Greenwood from UCLA will be up here momentarily. And Dr. Lanice Bias, the mother of the late, great Len Bias. And you were saying that you grew up in Maryland.
Yep.
I grew up in the Boston area.
Same county, by the way.
Yeah, and obviously what we're here tonight to do is to celebrate the life and the playing career at the University of Maryland of Len Bias, which was unbelievable. And for those that obviously aren't old enough to have witnessed it, it was something special. And we will always debate, you know, would he have been better than Jordan, the next Jordan, you know, all of those issues that certainly would have been talked about. And so we're just honored that the Bias family is here to be celebrated. And the era of David Greenwood and UCLA is unparalleled in men's college basketball. So momentarily, they will both be up here. But first, let's take a look.
The very best players in college basketball possess the ability to make those around them better. They boost confidence and elevate expectations. Ultimately, this special trait results in wins, lots of them. Two players who help their respective schools pile up victories and dominate their powerhouse conferences were UCLA big man David Greenwood and University of Maryland legend Len Bias. Playing collegiately in his hometown of Los Angeles from 1975 to 1979, David Greenwood became one of the anchors that helped usher in the post-John Wooden era at UCLA. Carrying the torch of continuing championship-level basketball, he led the Bruins to a stellar 102-17 record during his 4 years, emerging victorious in more than 85% of his 119 games. The imposing 6'9" forward made an immediate impact on the team, helping lead UCLA to the Final Four as a freshman. He continued to develop into a multi-dimensional star, becoming a three-time All-Conference selection, a two-time All-American, and team MVP as a junior and senior. At a school with a rich history of great players, Greenwood scored 1,721 career points to rank 13th on the Bruins' all-time scoring list. He was even more impressive on the glass, where his 1,022 rebounds ranked third all-time. He was drafted by the Chicago Bulls as the number 2 overall pick behind Magic Johnson in the 1979 NBA draft, and went on to play 12 years as a pro. Greenwood was inducted into the Pac-12 Hall of Honor in 2017. He now takes his place among college basketball's elite at the National Collegiate Basketball Hall of Fame. Len Bias was an electrifying force during his 4 years at the University of Maryland, becoming arguably the greatest talent to ever play at the school. The 6'8" forward had explosive quickness and leaping ability, finished at the rim with power, and possessed a jump shot with a smooth touch. From 1982 to 1986, Bias dominated the Atlantic Coast Conference in a way few players ever have. He led the league in scoring during his final two seasons and became one of only 10 players in history to win multiple ACC Player of the Year awards. The Maryland native helped Hall of Fame coach Leffie Drizel win 88 games and capture NCAA tournament wins all four of his years. He earned All-American honors as a junior and senior, capping his brilliant career by averaging 23 points and 7 rebounds per game his final season. In all, Bias scored 2,149 points over his Terps career, ranking third most in the school's record books. Bias was selected by the Boston Celtics with the number 2 overall pick in the 1986 NBA draft, but he tragically passed away shortly after. 35 years later, the memory of Len Bias and his stardom at Maryland still stands strong.
Please welcome to the stage UCLA's David Greenwood, and representing the late Len Bias, his mother, Dr. Lanice Bias.
Thank you. Thank you.
Welcome to you both. Dr. Bias, you told me something this afternoon that's stuck with me all day and I think will for quite some time. You mentioned how critical it is for those of us to celebrate the dash. Explain what that means.
Basically, no one knows the date or the time that they are going to transition. No one knows, has control over the date they're born or the date that they die. Only the dash that's in between, and the dash is the life that they live. And I believe that's why we're here today. My family and I are so grateful, celebrating the dash, the life of my late son, Len Bias.
That's great.
Dr. Bias, Len holds two of the top five scoring seasons in Maryland basketball history. He was an all-around player, but he was fun to watch. What was it about his game that drew people in?
Well, first of all, I have to be perfectly honest. I did an interview before I left home, and in terms of basketball, if it weren't for my husband, I was really dumb as mud. I really didn't know anything. And my husband explained to me that when Len left high school, when Len was playing ball in high school, that maybe he would get a scholarship to a college like Albert King at Maryland. And I was like, oh, really? And I didn't know. So all I was a mom that knew nothing about basketball until Len started playing, and my husband explained the game to me. And going to the games, knowing about the ACC, that's all I knew. I know what your question was, but I want to preface your question by saying something else. I never knew who Len Bias was until he died. I knew him as his mother. I had three other children, my husband, and moms are always scurrying around, multitasking. We're the trailblazers, the educators, the CEOs. You know, we're always working, always. And so I enjoyed the game. When we went, it was very entertaining, and all that happened in terms of him being honored because of his skills, but for real, I did not know who he was until he died, when our family received cards and letters from the White House, from the Hill. The first flowers that came to our home were from Michael Jordan and Larry Bird and Magic Johnson's mom calling, you know, when my second son died. There is just so much wrapped around Len. My husband and I keep looking at each other and just saying we're just overwhelmed to be here, and especially my husband, because a dad, as a father, he has covered his family. He never wavered, and I've been speaking and traveling for over 35 years, and he always released me to go. And knowing that the pain and all that he had inside, but just standing and covering and seeing him stand to cover his family and endure the pain of losing his son at the pinnacle of his career, and just knowing and believing, I know I'm not answering the way, but I'm just led to say this. It has been our faith that has brought us this far. And to get back to your question about Len, in terms of his scoring and his abilities, he was just blessed. That's all I could say, because we did not know he could play ball until he was in middle school and he just had an interest. Well, it was junior high school then. He had an interest in playing ball, and he made this this little thing in wood shop called eraser. They would call him the human eraser because He took a growing spurt and shot up, and he was playing ball and just blocking all of the shots. He was the biggest thing in the school. So anyhow, from there, he went on to high school, the feeder school, and from there, he went on to Maryland. And his game improved, his abilities improved, and I tell this story of how I didn't know what a six-pack was. Really, I did not know. I really did not know. But he took such good care of his body and fitness. Before fitness was the trend, he was fit. And I ran into a professor of someone of his not long ago, and they said that what they remembered was how he was built, how fit he was. So he was an athlete, he took good care of himself, and I was just so proud of him, even though I didn't know a lot. I was proud of him.
Thank you so much for sharing that. Thank you.
Thank you, Dr. Bice. This era in the early 80s and in men's college basketball in Maryland, you were before that era in the 70s. And for those that weren't alive then, haven't seen it, can't appreciate, what was it like to play for those UCLA teams?
Well, those UCLA teams were phenomenal because when you follow up, you have Kareem Abdul-Jabbar or Lou Alcindor at the time, you have Bill Walton, Marcus Johnson, you have all these greats that you have to follow behind. We weren't, I hate to say it, USC, you know, where you didn't have a basketball legacy. They had a football legacy of great football players. When you go to UCLA, you have to follow up because you're got a legacy of Coach Wooden, 12 championships, you know, 10 championships, the whole thing that he did. And it's such an honor to play at UCLA.
So did you really hate to say that about USC?
Oh, no, because
quiet kept,
we just beat them 60 to 37 just the other day, so I'm real, real happy right now.
We know. So your career, 49 double-doubles you had. That was third all-time for program history. How crucial was it for you to be an all-around player?
Well, at UCLA, we didn't have any individual person who just stood out. And, like, you know, Hersey was able to average 36 points a game. We had a bunch of NBA players. Mm-hmm. I mean, Marcus Johnson, NBA, Kiki Vandeweghe, NBA, Roy Hamilton, Brad Holland. I played on a team where you had five or six guys that could average 16, 17 points a game. So talking about just doing your part, going in there, filling in what the coach needed and doing what the team wanted was paramount back in those days. UCLA was all about team basketball. It wasn't about your individual accolades because, like Coach Wooden said, there's 50 guys before you that have had everything that you've already had. They've already been All-Americans and stuff. You're just one of the guys there, and I'm honored to be there.
Dr. Bias, when you see the video of Len in action, which a lot of us have obviously seen over the last 30 years, but what memories of his basketball playing career, which ones come back to you when you see that?
Can I tell you what really comes to me?
Sure, okay. Please.
My family and I are here, five of my six grandchildren, my husband and my niece and some other friends. But when I see any type of film or video of Len and I look at my family, what the Bias family did was honored what remained, if you can understand that. And so many times when people are going through tragedies and very hard things, and we've heard horrendous situations that people have had to deal with, especially in the last 2 years, honoring what remains means eating the loaf of bread that's in your hand and being grateful for what you have. And as torn up and as heartbroken as we were at Len's death and the times I begged to die, I did not want to live because I didn't think I could breathe again. I couldn't go on. And then to see this hour when we're all here. That's what it does for me. His athletic ability, fine. My husband and I, we're senior citizens, and the two of us are alone, and we enjoy sports. We look at tennis, basketball, football. We look at everything. And we draw from the current athletes. We enjoy, we talk about the athleticism of the young men and young women that are playing sports, more specifically basketball and tennis. We look at a lot of that and we enjoy it. So I know that Len was a seed that went down into the ground to bring forth life, and his death, in death, and the way he died changed so many people's lives in the way they thought about substance abuse and about his death. My husband and I have been in the store or out, and someone will walk up. We were in a store, and a man walked up and said, "When your son died, I never touched drugs again, ever." I get emails and letters from people and calls from people in Texas saying that I never touched drugs again, and I taught my children the same thing. And in death, in your son's death, he is bringing life, and thank you for your work. So that's what I see in Len. And another thing that I would like to say is I didn't know, I had this feeling that something was gonna happen almost 2 years before Len's death. It's been recorded in many of the interviews that I've done. But before Len's death, I am a Christian, and before his death, he came to me. He said, "Ma, you ought to hear this song called The Greatest Love of All. It's beautiful, and me, I'm holier than thou. Oh boy, I don't want to hear that. I don't want to hear that." No, Ma, you need to hear it. You need to listen to it. So finally, he bought it in, and I listened to it. But do you know, after his death, I was kicked out of my comfortable position and made to maximize my potential as a public speaker. And when I was speaking to young people, I would teach them about the song, The Greatest Love of All, and not realizing that Len had given me the messages to take to the young people after he died about the greatest love of all is the love that you must have for yourself. I'm a firm believer that our young people are reachable, teachable, lovable, and savable. We have to change our approach in adapting to their needs. And Len has done more in death, I believe, than he could have ever done in life because of the impact of his death has made on so many people in a positive manner, and being here to honor him today.
Thank you so much. And absolutely, I totally agree. As I said earlier, growing up in Prince George's County,
yes,
we thought he was ours.
Yes.
So it impacted my life, all my friends, very greatly and very positively. So thank you so much for sharing with us. Before we let you go, David, I texted with a friend of yours, Annie Myers.
Oh, Annie.
Yes, UCLA great.
Yes.
And she said congratulations, of course, and hello. And she told me a little story. We can talk about it after. I don't want to embarrass you in front of everybody.
Thank you.
But it got me to thinking about how great and what a premier program UCLA was, not just for men's basketball, women's basketball, as you mentioned, football, track and field. We know the names that have come out of that program. What was it like for you to have such a huge target on your back and still find such great success? You only lost 17 games your entire career there.
We were fortunate because when most teams walked into Poly Pavilion and they saw those championship banners, game was over. That's how powerful Poly Pavilion in UCLA was, is that everyone grew up watching it, and they always wanted to win. And I'm sure you have coaches out here that will speak to this. If they won one game, they want to win in Poly Pavilion. And if they beat Coach Bartow, who I played for, or Coach Cunningham, they were happy. It was like, hey, that made their year, because they can win 50-some games, but you beat UCLA one time, that's how powerful that school was. and is to this day because we have a great coach right now. We have a great coach.
Awesome. David Greenwood, Dr. Lanice Bias, yes. We so appreciate both of you coming
thank
here.
You both.
Thank you.
Thank you so much.
All right, we are going to shift to the coaching portion of our program here. Rick Bird and Tom Penders, as I said off the top, both had to start their careers without all the glamorous facilities and the money that comes with all of that, and really worked from the ground up building powers in the sport of men's college basketball. So, before we bring them up, Rick Bird and Tom Penders.
The life of a college basketball coach comes with high demands, big time pressure, and relentless intensity. The job requires both physical and emotional toughness. While the rewards of success can be high, longevity can be elusive. Two coaches who were able to achieve prominence for four decades are longtime Belmont coach Rick Bird and multi-school turnaround master Tom Penders. The name Rick Bird is synonymous with Belmont basketball. He ignited the school's rise to prominence and passionately guided its longtime record of success. For 33 years, the Tennessee native made his home state proud as the Bruins became a driving force in the surge of mid-majors' impact in college basketball. During his first decade, Bird built Belmont into a perennial NAIA powerhouse. His teams made five national tournament appearances, and he was named NAIA Coach of the Year in 1995. Bird then took the challenge of orchestrating Belmont's move to NCAA Division I in 1996. The success was swift as he started piling up 20-win seasons. He went on to capture 17 conference regular season and tournament championships. Bird led the Bruins to 8 NCAA tournament appearances. From 2011 to 2014, Belmont was one of only six programs to win 26 or more games each season, joining the likes of Duke and Florida. Combining his incredible record at Belmont with his early career stints at Maryville and Lincoln Memorial, Bird finished his career with an amazing total of 805 wins, making him the 12th winningest coach in Division I history. Among college basketball programs six decades or older, Bird retired first in Division I history in percentage of schools' all-time wins at 62%. His legacy at Belmont was honored with the court at Kirby Event Center being named in his honor. Throughout his coaching journey at seven different NCAA schools, Tom Penders always brought an up-tempo, entertaining style of basketball. He also brought victories, lots of them. His extraordinary ability to turn teams around quickly earned him the nickname Turnaround Tom. Penders started earning a national spotlight in 1986 with his dramatic takeover at Rhode Island. He inherited a program that had posted single-digit win totals four consecutive years, promptly notched 20 wins his first season. Then in year two, he led the Rams to a 28-7 record and a spot in the NCAA tournament, where they surprised many with a run to the Sweet 16. The Texas Longhorns came calling, and Penders again took a struggling program and immediately went 25-9 his first season. His running horns started filling the arena, and the following season charged all the way to the Elite Eight. In 10 seasons at Texas, Penders earned 8 NCAA tournament appearances and won 208 games, becoming the winningest coach in school history at that time. Penders finished his coaching career with 3 seasons at George Washington and 6 at Houston. Again at both schools, his first year resulted in a significant turnaround and a postseason berth. In all, Penders won 649 games as a collegiate head coach, ranking him in the top 40 in the NCAA record book. His imprint has been left on multiple schools and even more players all around the country.
Let's give a Hall of Fame welcome to our coaches, Rick Bird and Tom Penders.
Well, Rick, from Belmont to the National Collegiate Basketball Hall of Fame, when you took over at Belmont, what were your objectives?
Well, my first one was because I was also the athletic director and forgot to hire anybody to run the concession stand was to sell popcorn and soft drinks in the first game I ever coached there. That's a true story. You know, Belmont was an NAIA program, not a whole lot of success going on. Great city, great school, a lot of potential. David Lipscomb College, now Lipscomb University, had just won the national championship. They're 2 miles from our campus. So I guess the first order of business was to try hard to become successful, even with them. And I've said many times, even though they're our greatest rival, without their success, I don't think our success would have ever gotten there.
So, Coach, when you look at your resume, over 30 years at one school, at Belmont, you had 23 20-wins seasons, 4 seasons where you won 30 or more, only 5 losing seasons, no household names coming out of your program, at least not initially. How did you do that?
That's a hard question. Players, good players, making good choices in your staff, making good choices to bring people to Belmont that fit not only our basketball style of play, but what we expected in terms of values and character, and also that fit the school socially and academically. I think it's important, really important, to think about those things in recruiting, and that's not always done. And so our retention rate is among the very highest things that I would be proud of because we just didn't lose kids to transfer situations.
All right, Tom, first off, I'm curious, all the different schools that we rattled off there, how much of any of the previous stops that you have of the gear do you still have?
Well, actually, Andy, I tell people I couldn't hold on to a job. I couldn't hold on to a job. And I started as a high school coach, and then after 3 years, I was offered an opportunity to go to Tufts University, like 5 miles from the Boston Garden, you know where it is. And on that group of kids that I inherited, I learned a good lesson early. Never run a kid off. That you go and respect the player that you're inheriting from the other coach, respect the coach who was there. And I did that my whole career, and some of the best players I ever coached were kids that were left behind by the other coach. And a couple of them are here. Couple of my guys, one from Tufts, Eddie Tapscott, who went on to a great career in the NBA as a vice president of the Charlotte Bobcats. He was the head coach of the Washington Wizards for a while. He was chief of scouting. He now works for the Milwaukee Bucks. He's here. And Lance Blanks, who's general manager of the Phoenix Suns, first round pick of the Pistons. He was on that first year of Texas team. I looked at the points. He scored 8 points at Virginia in his career, transferred back to Texas. I had nothing to do with that. I was at Rhode Island then. And he ends up being a great basketball player. And it was a joy to watch him. And now we're best friends.
So one quick follow-up. The turnaround Tom that we hear, that I remember – I probably wrote that at some point, but I didn't name it, but I probably definitely used it in a sentence or said it on the air. But how the turnaround aspect, how did you end up doing that at each stop?
That's a question that's often asked. I just think my father was a legendary high school baseball coach, but when I was real little, he also coached basketball. And I watched him coach his players. And he always said, you know, you do the best as a coach to help your players be successful and win. And you've got to trust them before they trust you, your players. And that's what I think I tried to do. And honestly, the best advice, again, came from my dad. He said, and I treated every player just like I treat you. And I said, really? Because I have 2 brothers, and we had some serious battles. You're pretty tough on us, Dad. you're not as tough on the players. He said, well, they don't give me the lip you did. Anyway, I grew up in a coach's family. My nephew's the head baseball coach at UConn. We're very proud. UConn, University of Connecticut, is where I went. And, you know, I was a starter for 3 years back in Osage in the late 60s. People say, well, they didn't play any basketball back then. We averaged 86 points a game my first year, and we had two All-Americans. I had Toby Kimball, my center, and a guy named Wes Balasugni, who was in a three-way tie with Kareem Abdul-Jabbar, Lou Alcindor, and Jimmy Walker. Three-way tie, 30 points a game. And I was the guy passing to him all the time. But I was very lucky. I grew up in Connecticut, born in Bridgeport. That's where I grew up at my first coaching job. And you just try to get the most out of me. You know, coaches that yell at their kids, I'm just totally against that. Always have been. Now, maybe when I was a young guy, Eddie Tapscott will tell you that I didn't let him shoot enough. But I really had fun everywhere I was, every stop. And being here is beyond a dream for me. Coaches say, well, you know, you coach in seven different schools, et cetera. Well, early on in my career, I think when I left Tufts to go to New York, the Daily News headline was "Turn Around Tom," and nobody in New York knew who the hell I was. And it gave me a good line at banquets and things like that. So,
and we're still using it now.
Yeah, it meant nothing to me, believe me. It was...
Coach Bird, over 800 wins. Does one stand out to you?
Three or four or five probably do, but a cup. How about if I go with two?
Absolutely.
2006, we tied Lipscomb University for the A-Sun Championship regular season, played them in the championship game at East Tennessee State in Johnson City, and game went into overtime, and we pulled it out. And so that's the first trip to the NCAA tournament. I don't know if it gets any better than that feeling right there. And particularly to do it against such a rival who had turned Division I after us. And if they'd got there first, that would have been no fun in the city of Nashville. And then in 2019, we got an at-large bid to the tournament. And we played Temple in the first game. And we were able to beat them. And that was our first NCAA tournament win. So. And I knew that was my last year. So just getting that at-large bid under those circumstances and then getting that first win, those two stand at the top.
All right, I got to ask this real quick. Why the sweater vest?
You know, the story is this, that not long after I got to Belmont, Vanderbilt was playing Duke on TV, and C.M. Newton was the coach, as you remember Coach Newton. And they came out in sweater vests and golf shirts, the whole staff. I thought, well, if Vanderbilt can do that, if you can do that at Vanderbilt, surely. And I dressed it up a little bit and kept a dress shirt on underneath. But it's just more comfortable. I quit too early. All these guys now are wearing just. I think they're going to pull their shirt off and go in and play.
It's funny. Okay, thank you for that, by the way. So, Coach Penders, you made it to the Sweet 16 as a double-digit team. You did it three times. What's the secret to your success there?
Honestly, I know it's not a question of me being humble. I had great players who played together. The guys who couldn't shoot didn't jack up threes. But guys like Lance Blanks, Travis Mays, and Joey Wright, they had the green light because they earned it. And one thing I found out as a player and a coach, it's the guys who work the hardest at it that are the best. It's like any field, art, whatever, they're the best because they practice. And as coaches, Rick and I both know this. And I spent a good part of my career at a Belmont level with Fordham and Columbia and even George Washington, little school. So I didn't always coach in the big time. I was an overnight success in my 17th season. So anyway, thanks for the questions. Great question.
All right, well, congratulations to Tom Penders and Rick Byrd.
Yes.
All right, our next two inductees obviously had unbelievable NBA careers, Hall of Fame careers, but we are recognizing them obviously here because of their men's college basketball careers at two of the ultimate blue bloods at Kansas and North Carolina. Take a look.
From 1995 to 1998, the careers of two players who excelled for two of the most storied programs in college basketball history took a parallel path to stardom. Antoine Jameson of North Carolina and Paul Pierce of Kansas both played the small forward position. Both became first-team All-Americans, and both put together brilliant three-year college careers before entering the NBA together as top 10 draft picks. Still today, they are both revered among the all-time greats at their respective universities. The true definition of a matchup nightmare. Antoine Jameson's combination of size and skill struck fear into the hearts of opponents. The North Carolina phenom was a model of consistent production, game in and game out. During his 3 years at UNC, Jameson averaged 19 points and 9.9 rebounds per game, nearly pulling off a career double-double. His dominating performances helped lead the Tar Heels to back-to-back Final Fours in 1997, which was Coach Dean Smith's farewell season, and in 1998. The two-time All-American became the first player in ACC history to earn first-team All-Conference honors as a freshman, sophomore, and junior. In his third and final season, Jameson captured the Naismith and Wooden Awards as the nation's most outstanding men's college basketball player, and also became the sixth Tar Heel to be named NABC Player of the Year. Jameson finished his collegiate career ranked among the top eight all-time at North Carolina in both scoring and rebounding. His number 33 is one of only eight jerseys to be retired in the program's rich history. He was drafted fourth overall by the Toronto Raptors in the 1998 NBA draft and went on to a successful 16-year pro career. Still today, Antoine Jameson is regarded as one of the greatest players ever to don the Carolina blue and white. A California native, Paul Pierce demonstrated from an early age that he possessed the drive and determination to be an all-time great. After being cut from the Inglewood High School varsity team twice, he spent hours in the gym tenaciously perfecting his craft. By his senior year, he became a McDonald's All-American and the top-ranked recruit in the state. Pierce took his talents to Lawrence, Kansas, and would go on to become a Jayhawks legend. A high-octane scorer, Pierce made an immediate impact from the moment he took the floor at Fog Allen Fieldhouse. He averaged double-figure scoring in all three seasons at KU. In his final year as a junior, Pierce poured in over 20 points per game and was a consensus All-American. Pierce's talents helped lead the Jayhawks to 98 wins, three conference titles, and two league tournament championships, where he was crowned MVP on both occasions. Just a few short years from having to prove himself as a young high schooler, Pierce finished his career as the fifth leading scorer in Kansas history with 1,768 career points. Pierce was selected 10th overall in the 1998 NBA draft by the Boston Celtics. His illustrious pro career included scoring over 26,000 points and winning an NBA title in 2008. Such is Pierce's impact on the game of basketball that he is universally known simply as the Truth.
Please welcome two legends from tradition-rich programs, Antoine Jameson and Paul Pierce.
All right, so I'm going to do one quick thing to switch up here. I actually, for both of you, I'll start with you, Antoine, since you were the same draft, 4-10, in terms of picks. Scouting report in college basketball of Paul and then Paul of Antoine. Kansas, Carolina, you go first.
I mean, Coach talked about it earlier. I mean, he was one of those guys that was difficult to defend. His size, agility, he can score from the inside, score from the outside. So I think the thing, if I was a coach, I would like to get him up and down the court to get him a little tired and make him play a little defense. But other than that, I mean, he was the complete package. The nickname sticks. He's the truth when he's out there on the basketball court.
Twan had this shot, this mid-range shot, that it was like a floater in the middle. And I remember guarding him as a pro, and I just wondered, like, how is this going in? Because sometimes I felt like he'll throw it up without looking at the rim, and it's still going in. But he was quick around the basket, very athletic. You know, we had to play against each other in the McDonald's game. Mm-hmm. And, you know, just to see our growth from that period to college, you know, because we were like parallel. You know, I thought I was in the rank. I thought I was up for National Player of the Year, but he just won all the awards. I was just like, what I got to do, you know? And then I slipped in the draft and everything. But Twan was a phenomenal player all the way from high school all the way through. He kind of redefined that position. He reminded me a lot of James Worthy. You know, he was really quick because power forwards back then were big and strong and muscly, but he had the quickness. He'd get by you, dunk on you, shoot the mid-range, shoot the three. He had the complete package.
How about I trade one of those trophies for one of that ring you got in the office? Yeah, exactly. Oh,
I got lucky. Playing with some great players.
We saw that your jersey was retired at Carolina, mm-hmm. one of only eight. From a very storied program with tons of players that went on to have NBA careers, Hall of Fame careers, what does that mean that you're one of only eight?
It's one of the most amazing feelings in the world. To know the rich tradition of the University of North Carolina. Of course, you have guys like Michael Jordan, James Worthy, Phil Ford, and for myself to be coach under Coach Smith and Coach Guthridge. And for me, it was just the skinny kid from Charlotte, North Carolina. Had the dreams of going to college, fulfilling the promise I made to my parents. And then once I got to that college, I trusted everything that Coach Smith and that coaching staff wanted me to do. I went out there and did everything, and to see that hard work pays off. And now that I have kids of my own, for them to go back up, and I'm like, hey, man, you got a lot to try to accomplish that jersey up there. But it's just gratifying to know that the work ethic that my parents instilled in myself, it paid off. But to have my jersey up there with the grace to come through North Carolina, it's hard to put in words.
So you said you wanted to fulfill a promise to your parents. We know that you left early. And I'm not sure if everyone knows this, but he went back and got his degree immediately.
Oh, man. Yeah.
So why was that important to you?
I was the first one in the family to accomplish that. And I remember when Coach Smith and Coach Guthrie came into our homes. And they was like, look, I can't promise you that he will be this NBA player. I can't promise you that, you know, he'll be whatever on the basketball court. But the two things that I can promise you is that he would get his college degree, and then he would become a better man than what he did before he came to the University of North Carolina. So for me, that was a promise that no matter what happened, I was going to fulfill that and get my education.
Amazing.
Hold on. I have one question.
Oh, please.
These two
now,
most Carol- important
no, 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 no. Carolina's had, I can name about 50 great Carolina players. What's the criteria to only have eight? Like, how good do you have to, I mean, you have to win National Player of the Year to get?
Yeah, you do, I think. Yeah.
Really?
Yeah.
Wow. That's high standards in Carolina.
And part of the problem.
We'll send you the tape.
But part of the problem is you had, a lot of times you had multiple great players on one team.
That's the thing.
Only one guy can win Player of the Year.
That's tough.
Yeah.
Paul, you came from California. I think. In the times I've been at Fog Allen Fieldhouse, I feel like I've lost hearing and have had rock, you know, that song just in my head, and I haven't been there that much. For you, experiencing that during your career at Kansas, what was it like to play in that arena?
Well, first of all, that's the reason I went to Kansas. You know, being a kid out of California, I went to numerous UCLA, USC games. I had tickets to all the games senior year, so I went to games every week. I took one visit to Kansas. It was during, like, around this time of the year, so a lot of kids went home for Thanksgiving, and it was just the kids and the fans who came to the game. So there was no, you know, you go on a recruiting trip, you know, you go to party. It was no party. It was just the game. And so I go to the game, and they're playing against, I believe it was San Diego. And the crowd was phenomenal. And then they're cheering. They started chanting my name. I didn't even know they knew I was there. And I'm sitting in the stands as a kid. And they're like, "We want Paul." And I'm like, chills. So I'm like, "I'm coming here." And that's when I knew. I was like, "I'm going to be a Jayhawk. You know what, Mom? I'm sorry I can't stay home. You know, most kids stay close to home. I was the last one out the house. I was the youngest in my family. And I was like, I'm going to Kansas. I'm not coming back." And so it was something about that crowd. I mean, the chant, the rock, chalk, J-R-K. I never seen nothing like this. And like I said, I went to UCLA, and they won the national championship, and not one game I seen was a crowd like that. And I was like, this is the place where I need to play.
It suited you.
Yeah, I loved it. It was amazing.
All right, two Final Fours for you in 3 years. I mean, it seems almost silly, right, to talk about the amount of success you had at Carolina. What was it like in that moment? What was that journey like, and what did Coach instill in you guys to make you believe it was possible?
Anytime you're around great coaches, Paul, the same with Coach Williams, there's always something about that coach. You know, Coach Smith, I can remember my sophomore year, we started the conference off like 0-2, 0-3, and a lot of talk around, you know, the basketball program and things of that nature. We play in NC State. We might have been down like 8 points with like less than a minute. And you have these 17-year-olds and 18-year-olds who are just like, you know, frantic and upset. And he comes in there with this calmness. He said, "We're going to trap the ball. You're going to get a turnover. We're going to score. They're going to come back in. We're going to get a stop. They're going to score. They're going to call a timeout. We're going to get this." And I'm like, "All right, Coach. Yeah, okay. Trap the ball. We get a turnover. We score." They come down, we get a stop, we score, and we like down by one. And he just comes in there just calm and like, "I told you." And you want to do any and everything possible. But for us, we had a close-knit team. Guys like Vince Carter, McIntyre Njai, Brendan Haywood, Shamon Williams. And that sophomore year, we didn't know it, ended up being Coach Smith's last year coaching. And for us to know that we had a talented team, but we were still trying to figure some things out, and to not win a national championship that year, it put us on a mission that junior year. Coach Guthridge, who was a longtime assistant for Coach Smith for a lot of years, he just came in, and it was just like riding the bike. Everything was smooth sailing, and we was destined to win it that year. And that year was probably the most fun I had playing a game of basketball, because it was 12, 13 guys all in. No complaints, whatever you want from us, we're going to do everything to represent that North Carolina on the front of our jerseys. So to go through two Final Fours, a lot of guys don't even get the opportunity to do that. You know, me and Paul was talking earlier, like, you know, we never got a chance to play each other in college. You know, normally it would have been either through a tournament at the beginning of the year or the NCAA tournament. And throughout our journey in college, both teams were always in the top 10, top five, but that opportunity never presented itself. But to have did it with Coach Guthridge and Coach Smith under the whims was an opportunity of a lifetime. And not only that, my teammates, who's still to this day, you know, we talk about, you know, we was talking about Carolina basketball today. You know, we got that Carolina feed, and it's just that friendship and that tightness that we had will never go away. And unfortunately, we didn't get a chance to win it, but definitely blessed to have had that experience, especially with those guys.
So I want to pick up on that point to you, Paul. Look, not everyone plays college basketball. Not everyone has to play college basketball. We're in a different era, and that's fine. But what did you get out of college basketball that helped you become a Hall of Fame NBA player? And everything that's basically happened, you know, in your life since leaving Kansas?
Yeah, well, I pretty much got everything because as a high school kid, I was an All-American. And, you know, as an All-American high school, you were pretty good, pretty dominant. But it wasn't until I got to Kansas and played under Roy Williams that I got coached and I learned discipline. I learned, you know, very hard. I knew hard work, but I knew very hard work under him. And these are things that helped me in life and on the next level. I didn't even know how to play a ball screen when I got to Coach Williams. You know, just like pick and roll, I was like, what do I do, Coach? You know, okay, you got to fight over, son. And so, or come off a down screen and take a shot. So I learned little small fundamentals of the game that he taught me to help me at the next level. And so I'll be always greatly appreciative of that. You know, I always say Roy taught me the game. I played the game, but he taught me the game. And it just, like when people say he wasn't overly athletic, you know, how was he able to score? A lot of that had to do with Roy Williams. You know, so he taught me the intangibles and things of that nature. And it helped me at the next level. And, you know, it was the best choice I made because I had a lot of coaches that recruited me where I could have been the man off the top. And, you know, the one thing I learned, and he said, you know, he was the most honest coach, though. You know, I was getting recruited in. You know, coach is like, all right, we're going to build around you. You're going to, whatever position you want to play, we're going to put you there. Coach was like, hey, you know, you might not even start, you come here, but you know what? I was like, and I respected that.
Yeah.
And I was like, you know, he really going to push me. He said, you're going to, but you will work hard and you will get an education. And I was like, that's good enough for me. I'm here.
Common theme.
Yeah.
Both of you said the same thing. Your coaches were honest and they said you're going to get an education. I think that's.
Yeah.
So important. Message to all the kids at home. Get your education. All right, before we let you go, Tuan, fondest memory of being a Tar Heel?
Oh, man. Whether it was a Monday, Tuesday game against Duke, to see guys like James Worthy, all the greats, to walk down that hall, to hear that band, to see that sea of just Carolina blue. And now, when I go back, even when I make the drive back to Chapel Hill, all those memories just come back. But, you know, just putting on that jersey, you know, I just imagine Coach Smith on that knee just talking, and not just about the game of basketball, but just about, you know, did you call your mom today? I'm like, Coach, I'm in college. What do you mean going there and call your mom right now? Just those life lessons that you learn. But for me, running out that tunnel when I go to the game still to this day to see that blue, those are the memories that to the day I die will always be instilled in myself. So you hear a lot of people talk about I'm a Tar Heel to the day I die, and that's definitely the definition of who I am, but those are the memories that will never go away.
All right, Paul, your turn. What do you remember most about being a Jayhawk?
What I remember most is probably Roy Williams throwing me out of that practice. Man, I was like, man, what? I've never been thrown out of practice before until he did it. I was like, Coach, why did I deserve to get thrown out of practice? He's like, you're not going hard. I said, I'm practicing on a sprained ankle. I'm still practicing. But no, really, it was just the fans, the people, the relationships, you know, that you build in college, growing up from a boy into a man. You know, that's my fondest memories, you know, because college is your last chance to be a kid. You know, and then once you're done with college, you go into adulthood, whether it's in the workforce or, in my case, I'm able to play in the NBA, and it's serious business then. So just remember those good old times, hanging with your teammates, being fun, being a kid again. Those memories will never go away.
Ladies and gentlemen, two great ones, Antoine Jamison, Paul Pierce. Wow.
Wow. All right.
What a class.
So now comes the hardware. All of these individuals have won something in their career. They wouldn't be here. But we're going to give them more. So we were going to now bring up Craig Robinson from the NEBC.
Yes, the executive director.
Yes. And Kevin Henderson, who is the CEO of the College Basketball Experience.
Yes. Gentlemen.
And if we could, the entire class, all 8 of you, if you could come back up, please.
Yes. Everybody come up.
On behalf of the NABC Foundation and all those associated with this great game of ours, it is my pleasure to welcome you to the National Collegiate Basketball Hall of Fame with the presentation of these awards. Congratulations to the class of 2021.
Our first medal presentation is for the late, great Len Bias, represented by his mother, Dr. Lenice Bias.
UCLA Bruins superstar, David Greenwood.
Scoring icon from Bradley, Percy Hawkins.
From The Ohio State University, Jim Jackson.
From the North Carolina University, University of North Carolina, the ultimate Tar Heel, Antoine Jameson.
One of the greatest Jayhawks ever, Paul Pierce.
From Belmont, the pride of Nashville, Rick Bird.
And turnaround mastermind, Tom Penders.
All right, team photo here. All right, now just the Hall of Famers.
Thank you everybody for coming out and celebrating the 2021 class, and congratulations again.